crowd began to shout, "Raise the ladders." Company 20 had the tallest ladder in the fire department. It swung into position, and a team of men began to crank its lifting gears. A hush fell over the crowd. The ladder continued to rise. One girl on the ninth floor ledge slowly waved her handkerchief as the ladder crept toward her. Then the men stopped cranking. The ladder stopped rising. The crowd yelled in one voice, "Raise the ladders!" But the ladder had been raised. It was raised to its fullest length. It reached only to the sixth floor. The crowd continued to shout. On the edge, the girl stopped waving her handkerchief. A flame caught the edge of her skirt. She leaped for the top of the ladder, almost 30 feet below her, missed, and hit the sidewalk like a flaming comet.
That day, I went to the office as usual. I and some of my fellow co-workers were asked to come later in the afternoon for work. When I returned to the factory after lunch, some journalists warned me not to go inside the building as cracks were beginning to appear in its walls. But the factory supervisor asked us to go inside and work. We entered the factory and started our work. I completed 2 garments. The helpers gave us some more thread. Then, suddenly, the manager asked us to run away. The building had started collapsing. When I was running suddenly, I felt something fall on my head. I fell straight down. I tried pulling myself out, but I was deep inside. My whole body, except my head, was under the collapsed roof. There was little space to move. I could hardly breathe. As I tried moving my right hand, I saw something falling on my hand, and after that, I could not pull my hand back. It became immobile. On the fourth day, someone from outside made a hole in the wall and asked us whether we were alive or not. The moment I saw someone, I asked for water. We were in the debris for 3 days. We had to drink urine for survival. Others who were stuck in the debris did the same thing.
Purchased on average 64
items. Killed and harmed workers over there.
Paid only 64 cents an hour.
Rescued at least 30 children from sweatshops in
factories
in
around the world. Sweatshops and by underage
allegations of forced
overtime. Tabloid reports that the line was made
by
workers
for
cheaper and cheaper clothing using cheaper materials and cheap labor.
While American childhood memories consist of summer camp, school, and Little League, in the developing world, an estimated 168 million children between the ages of 5 and 14 work in sweatshops. The conditions in these workplaces are deplorable. The workers typically live in dormitories, which are often 12 by 12 rooms made entirely of cement. They are paid what most Americans would consider to be unacceptable wages. In fact, 3.5 million garment factory workers in Bangladesh make the equivalent of $10 a week. And one of the companies that takes advantage of sweatshop labor has just opened up a new store here in State College, H&M. As the greatest consumer of textiles from Bangladesh, which has a minimum wage of $38 a month, H&M has been a major player in the controversy surrounding sweatshop labor. In fact, the United Students Against Sweatshops here at Penn State protested the opening of H&M, while many of their fellow students filed in line to buy the trendy clothing.
Protesting H&M was definitely difficult because we saw so many people walking in very excited to buy this clothing, but the majority of the people just didn't really understand the implications of buying this clothing. But it was cool because a lot of them would ask, and just seeing us protesting made them realize, like, hey, maybe there is a problem. Sweatshops are bad because they really don't take into account how the workers are feeling and the safety and the health of the workers. They exploit the workers to no end, and I don't think that we should be supporting that kind of industry.
Many might think that the Rana Plaza factory collapse has promoted steps for safer working conditions amongst workers in places such as Bangladesh. And yes, this is true. More than 200 clothing companies signed a binding agreement to work toward a safer and healthier environment in the Bangladeshi garment industry. But it was soon found that many of the companies were not following through on their promises in making safety improvements, especially H&M. And guess who signed this commitment first? That's right, H&M. A study conducted by the Clean Clothes Campaign still found rather hard working conditions in H&M's platinum and gold suppliers, factories which claim to have the highest standards in labor conditions and make up 24% of their factories in Bangladesh. 61% of these factories do not have appropriate fire safety exits, putting almost 80,000 lives in danger. Yet H&M has communicated to consumers that all significant repairs for safety have been completed.
And if you thought it only happened at H&M, think again. Workers at Nike are paid an average of $1.60 a day when those workers need $3 a day to survive. In addition, they are expected to work an average of 60 to 70 hours a week. Walmart was one of the major brands the Rana Plaza factory supplied to, and the company was accused of forcing sweatshop workers there to endure 19-hour shifts while only earning $20 a month, lower than the minimum wage in Bangladesh. Victoria's Secret's biggest secret is its support for abusive labor in Jordan, where workers are slapped and beaten if their production was subpar and are forced to work overtime without pay, and where children are exploited picking cotton to make lingerie for the retailer. And even Disney, the so-called happiest place on earth, sells clothing made with child labor from China and Bangladesh. The children earn 33 to 41 cents an hour without receiving health benefits or a pension.
Who is at fault for the despicable conditions that these laborers work in? A possible culprit that one could point to are the CEOs of these clothing companies. The average salary of a CEO in the apparel industry makes over $7 million a year, while a few chief executive officers, such as the CEOs of Ralph Lauren and Gap, make more than $15 million a year. Is it on them to take a minor pay cut in order to improve the conditions in their factories, especially when one considers that their salaries are over 1,000 times higher than their workers who toil in these factories?
However, maybe this is our fault. We buy clothes for dirt cheap prices without thinking about where they're coming from.
We know deep down that these products were made through the use of cruel and unfair labor practices, yet we buy them anyway.
And after a few years, once we no longer feel trendy, we buy the same clothes. Again, and again and again. Far more than we need to.
If we could be more conscious about where we're getting our clothing from, or at the very least, if we could be buying more sustainable purchases, we could affect change on a large scale and improve the lives of thousands of sweatshop workers.